Hello everyone, today in this video I will tell you the details of cerebral palsy. Learning objectives for today's lecture are: how will you define the cerebral palsy, what are the incidence, types or classification of cerebral palsy, etiology, pathogenesis, then the clinical features of cerebral palsy, then how will you diagnose, then investigation, treatment and prevention of cerebral palsy. Definition of cerebral palsy. Cerebral palsy is a static encephalopathy. It is due to permanent and non-progressive disturbance in the developing fetus or infant brain. So whenever we are making the diagnosis of cerebral palsy, we have to rule out all other conditions in which acute or progressive damage to the brain occur. Example, if the patient is having acute encephalopathy due to infection or some poisoning, we cannot make the diagnosis of cerebral palsy. If patient is having the progressive damage in the brain, example, neurodegenerative disorder, again we cannot make the diagnosis of CP. It will lead to the permanent and progressive impairment of movement, tone and posture, which causes the activity limitation. It is also associated with other comorbid condition. Example, patient is having the epilepsy, cognitive dysfunction, speech, visual, hearing disturbance, intellectual or behavior problem. So always remember, it is a non-progressive or static encephalopathy which causes the progressive impairment of movements, tone and posture. Means the damage is non-progressive, but the symptom complex is going to be progress. So this is the definition of CP. Incidence of cerebral palsy is more in the male child compared to the female. So ratio of male to female is 1.4:1. Prevalence of CP varies from 1.5 to 2.5 per 1000 live births. When the weight of the newborn is less than 1 kg, the prevalence of CP increases drastically, 15 per 100. Now the types or classification of CP. It is the most important part to make the diagnosis. Topographic classification, physiological classification and functional classification. Topographic classification indicates the involved extremities, and while the physiological classification identifies the major motor abnormality which is present in a child, and functional classification tells about the severity of the condition. So this is the most important classification. There are various other classification also, but for the UG and PG exam point of view and to make the diagnosis, at least we have to involve these three classifications. In topographic classification, if only single limb is involved, we label as a monoplasia. If patient is having weakness more in the lower limb compared to the upper limb, we label as a diplegia. If half of the body is involved, we label as a hemiplegia. If patient is having involvement of upper limb is more than lower limb, we label as a double hemiplegia. When both lower limbs with one upper limb is affected, we label as a triplegia. When all four limbs are affected equally, we label as a quadriplegia. When only lower limbs are affected, upper limbs are normal, we label as a paraplegia. So in this, you have to remember the difference between diplegia and double hemiplegia and difference between this to the quadriplegia. In these three conditions, all four limbs are affected, but in quadriplegia, all four limbs are equally affected, while in the double hemiplegia, upper limbs are more affected than the lower limbs, and in diplegia, lower limbs are more affected than the upper limbs. In physiological classification, if there is involvement of pyramidal tract and patient is having a spasticity, we label as a spastic CP. If due to involvement of extrapyramidal tract, patient is having involuntary movements, we label as a athetoid or choreoathetoid or extrapyramidal or dyskinetic CP. If there is involvement of cerebellum and patient is having all the features of cerebellum involvement, we label as a ataxic CP. If due to extensive brain damage, patient is having atonia, we label as a atonic CP, and sometimes the picture is mixed. So we label as a mixed CP. So this is the physiological classification. Now functional classification. In this, according to the severity, we grade the CP. So in grade 1, there is no limitation of physical activity. Grade 2, when there is mild to moderate limitation, and grade 3 when there is moderate to severe limitation of activity, and grade 4 when there is no activity, complete limitation, no movement, patient is totally bedridden. Now the etiology of cerebral palsy, it's divided into antenatal causes, natal causes at the time of birth, and postnatal causes. In antenatal causes, when there is intrauterine exposure to the maternal infection occur, fetal damage can occur, and cerebrovascular accident, a stroke or infarct to the fetal brain can occur. Some congenital malformation, example neural tube defects or other malformation of the brain, example if the patient is having zygencephaly, porencephaly, then patient can develop the cerebral palsy. And some genetic and microtional defect can lead to this. And chances of developing the cerebral palsy is more in multiple gestations when the premature birth and the intrauterine growth retardation and the very low birth weight baby is there. In natal causes, intrapartum asphyxia is the main cause for the developing the CP. So whenever patient is having the birth asphyxia due to any cause, example due to prolonged or obstructed labor, due to abnormal presentation, or due to instrumental delivery, example forceps or vacuum delivery, patient can develop the CP later on. In postnatal causes, neonatal hyperbilirubinemia can lead to the conictus and it can lead to the cerebral palsy. Neonatal sepsis, pyomeningitis can lead to the cerebral palsy. Intracranial hemorrhage, ischemic brain injury in newborn period, and metabolic, genetic, and some endocrine disorder can also cause the development of cerebral palsy. Now the etiology in association with the motor syndrome and also its neuropathology. So I will tell you the details of all these types of CP, what are the etiology associated with a specific motor syndrome and what is the neuropathology. Spastic CP is the most common type of CP. Out of this, spastic diplegia is the most common form. It is present in around 35% cases. Causes of spastic diplegia are prematurity, low birth weight, hemorrhage, ischemia, infections, endocrine and metabolic disorder. But it is mainly seen whenever there is a history of premature birth. In neuropathology, you will find that periventricular leukomalacia will be the findings because the white matter adjacent to the ventricle is more susceptible for the hypoxic brain damage in premature babies. So this is the characteristic of spastic diplegia. Now the spastic hemiplegia, it is the second common type of the CP. It is present in around 25% cases. And in this, thrombophilic disorder is the main etiology which lead to the spastic hemiplegia, because thrombophilic disorder will cause the infarction in the brain. Infection, some genetic and developmental disorder, periventricular hemorrhagic infarction can lead to the spastic hemiplegia. In neuropathology, either a stroke in the cerebral cortex, in middle cerebral artery territory during the antenatal period or neonatal period, sometimes focal infarct, cortical or subcortical damage, parasitic cerebral damage or some cortical malformation will be the finding in brain. Spastic quadriplegia is the third common type of the CP. It is present in around 20% cases and it is the most severe form of the CP. And in this, the birth asphyxia is the main etiology which lead to the spastic quadriplegia. So whenever there is a history of severe birth asphyxia and patient is having HI grade 3, there is more chances of developing the spastic quadriplegia. Other causes are birth trauma, some endocrine, metabolic and genetic disorders. Ischemia and infection can lead to the spastic quadriplegia. In neuropathology, you will find that patient is having parasagittal cerebral damage, sometimes multicystic encephalomalacia or multifocal ischemic brain damage, status marmoratus, cortical malformation, selective neuronal necrosis is there. Athetoid CP is present in around 15% cases. It is comparatively rare to the spastic CP. And it is most likely associated with the asphyxia and conictus, which developed due to hyperbilirubinemia in neonatal period. Sometime mitochondrial disorder, genetic or metabolic disorder, example glutaric aciduria. In this, the athetoid CP will be the presentation. But it is mainly seen after conictus and asphyxia. And in neuropathology, you will find that the damage in the basal ganglia, putamen, globus pallidum, and thalamus or hippocampus occur. Ataxic CP is rare, present in less than 5% cases, and this is also associated with the birth asphyxia and infection. In this, the lesion in the cerebellum will be present. Atonic and mixed CP is very rare. And it is also associated with the birth asphyxia, infections during the antenatal neonatal period, and some genetic and metabolic disorder. In neuropathology, you will find that extensive brain damage is present. And sometimes patient is having the mixed CP. When the patient is having the spasticity with some other involuntary movements are also there, which is fit into the other athetoid type. And sometimes patient is also having the associated ataxia. So mixed CP is also very rare and severe form. Now the pathogenesis of cerebral palsy. Whenever there is intrauterine or peripartum asphyxia in the fetus or newborn, it will lead to the fetal acidosis and hypoxia, and it will cause the intracellular edema, and it will lead to the increased cerebral tissue pressure, and then cerebral blood flow will be decreased due to increased pressure, and it will lead to the further cerebral edema and necrosis, and cerebral tissue will be collapsed and involutes, and it will lead to the nodular sclerotic microglia. So this is a pathogenesis behind the brain damage which occur in the CP child during the fetal or infant period. Now, clinical features in cerebral palsy. Early signs which suggest the cerebral palsy. Then there are some soft neurological signs. And according to the specific type of CP, there are specific clinical features. So what are the early signs which suggest the cerebral palsy? In this, if the patient is having the persistence of primitive reflex, we should suspect the cerebral palsy. If patient is having excessive lethargy, irritability, high pitch cry, then again we have to suspect. If the patient is having delayed development milestones, if patient is having abnormal muscle tone, either hypotonia or hypertonia, or an abnormal posture, example seizuring, arcing of body is there, then we should suspect. If development of hand preference in very early age, even before the 1 year, which is characteristically present in hemiplegic CP, we should suspect. If Drake's the feet like commando signs or toe walking, which is present in spastic diplegia, we should suspect. And mothers usually complain of difficulty in toilet care and carrying the child in lap, then we should suspect that patient is going to develop the CP. Now in soft neurological sign, head bobbing, foot tapping, dysteadokinesia, choreoathetoid movements, finger agnosia, verbal dyspraxia, strabismus, and attention deficit. All these are the soft neurological signs on the basis of which we can suspect the CP. Now, according to the type of CP, there are specific features. Now, the symptoms according to the type of CP. In spastic diplegia, when lower limbs are more affected than upper limb, there will be seizing of legs will be there. And difficulty in applying the diaper because of the seizing of legs. And commando crawl, patient will drag the lower limbs when it will start to crawl. Delayed walking will be there, tiptoe walking will be there. And patient will not be able to sit. In the spastic diplegia, there will be difficulty in sitting. So all these are the features of spastic diplegia. And in signs, patient will have the brisk dip tendon reflex, bilateral Babinski sign will be there, ankle clonus will be there. There are very minimal chances of developing the epilepsy or seizure. And intellectual remains normal in almost all cases of spastic diplegia. So they are trainable and IQ is normal in most of the patients of spastic diplegia. In spastic hemiplegia, it is commonly present on right side. And in this, weakness is more in the upper limb compared to the lower limb. And in infants, you will find that asymmetrical motor reflex is there. And early hand preference will be there. Even in less than 1 year age group baby, you will find that infant is only using the single limb. And delayed walking will be there. And circumductive gait due to hemiplegia. And equinovarus deformity of the foot on the affected side. And Babinski sign, brisk reflexes, ankle clonus will be present on affected side only. There are chances of developing the seizure in 30 to 35% cases, and it is mainly partial seizure, sometimes generalized seizure also. And mental retardation is present in around 25% cases in spastic hemiplegia. Spastic quadriplegia is the most severe form of the CP. In this, marked motor impairment of all extremities, swallowing difficulties because of the bulbar involvement. Patient is having the more chances of aspiration pneumonia because of the swallowing difficulties, growth failure, windswept deformity in this, hip dislocation, scoliosis present. Brisk reflex, increased tone and spasticity will be present in all four limbs, clasp knife spasticity, bilateral Babinski sign, ankle clonus will be there. And 100%, almost 100% patients are having the seizures whenever there is a spastic quadriplegia. And mental retardation is also almost present in all cases of spastic quadriplegia. And speech, hearing and visual impairment is also present in spastic quadriplegia. So this is the most severe form of the CP. Now in athetoid CP, involvement of upper limb is more than lower limb, and the clinical feature, initially patient is having the hypotonia with poor head control with marked head leg in athetoid CP. Later on there will be hypertonia, increased tone with the rigidity, and dystonia develops. Whenever a patient is having the hypotonia and later on hypertonia, then it can be CP, but reverse is not true for the CP. Example, if the patient is having hypertonia initially and later on developing the hypotonia, then this is not the case of CP. This is any other etiology. So always remember that in most of the CP, initial stage patient may have the hypotonia and later on develop the hypertonia. So in athetoid CP, this is the characteristic that initially patient is having hypo, then develop the hyper, and the feeding difficulty will be there. And characteristically, patient is having the involuntary movements, slow writhing, choreoathetoid movements, which is absent during the sleep time, and reflexes are normal in athetoid CP. and seizures are also uncommon in ethidot CP. Intellectual remains normal mostly, and patient is having speech may be absent or slurring will be there. So speech and the hearing is affected in the ethidot CP. In ataxic CP, due to cerebellum involvement, patient is having the all cerebral sign, wide-based gait, ataxic gait will be there. Intentional tremor, whenever patient will perform any task, there will be tremor start, and hypotonia will be there, nystagmus will be there. Seizures are uncommon, but patient is having the learning disability because of intellectual will be affected. Also having the speech and vision impairment, and scanning speech will be characteristically present in ataxic CP. In atonic CP, there will be lack of tone because of patient is having the extensive brain damage. Atonia will be there, and failure of the muscle to respond to the stimulus because of the complete atonia. Patient will not able to even stand, walk, or perform any activity. You have to differentiate the atonic CP from the athetoid CP. In initial stage of athetoid CP, patient is having the hypotonia, and in atonic CP also patient is having the hypotonia. The differentiating feature between both is no involuntary movement will be present in the atonic CP while it is present in the athetoid CP. And there will be brisk reflex in atonic CP while the reflexes are normal in athetoid CP. And seizures are commonly present in atonic CP, and generally there are chances of developing the infantile spasm in this. This is the myoclonic seizure, and patient is having the profound mental retardation. Speech, vision, both are impaired in the atonic CP. In this video, you can see the child is having the bilateral ankle clonus. After dorsiflexion of the ankle, if more than 5 jerks are there, we label as a ankle clonus. In normal patient, after doing the dorsiflexion, either limbs will become in normal position or less than 5 jerks will be there. So whenever there is a more than 5 jerks, we label as a ankle clonus. And this is the child who is having the quadriplegic CP and having the bilateral ankle clonus. Now the diagnosis of CP. After thorough physical examination, we have to classify the CP according to the physiological, topographic, functional and etiological classification. Example, in physiological, patient is having spastic, athetoid or ataxic or atonic CP. According to the topographic, patient is having monoplegia, diplegia, quadriplegia or etc. According to the functional, severity of the CP, and according to the etiology, we have to mention in the diagnosis. And with this, we have to mention the associated comorbid condition which are present in our case. Example, mental retardation is present or not, seizures are present or not, speech, hearing, visual defects, behavior problems, involuntary movements are there or not. So this is the way to make the diagnosis of CP. Now, investigation for cerebral palsy. There is no specific test to diagnose the cerebral palsy. We have to plan the investigations to rule out the progressive disorders of CNS. Example, degenerative diseases, metabolic genetic disorders and malignancy. So all these should be ruled out. Then we have to plan the investigation to know the etiology of cerebral palsy. For this, we have to send the neuroimagings, USG cranium, CT scan, MRI brain, electroencephalogram for the seizures. And then we have to assess the visual and hearing. And also we have to assess the developmental and intelligent quotient. In neuroimaging, USG cranium should be performed in neonates. And it's very useful to detect the intracranial hemorrhage, hydrocephalus and periventricular leukomalacia in preterms newborn. And in terms newborn, it's useful for detection of hypoxic ischemic injury in cortical, subcortical region or thalami or basal ganglia. Serial USG should be performed at 3rd, 7th and 30th days of life in neonates. CT scan is not routinely indicated. When we are finding that focal neurological signs or focal seizures are present, or patient is having microcephaly or hydrocephalus, then we have to perform the CT scan. MRI brain is the imaging modality of choice for the cerebral palsy. It is indicated to determine the location and extent of a structural lesion in brain stem and basal ganglia. In first 24 hours of life in newborn, diffusion weighted MRI imaging is very sensitive. It can detect the injury in the brain. During this time, T1 T2 weighted MRI imaging will be normal, while diffusion weighted MRI imaging can detect the injury. EEG should be performed for evaluation of seizures in a CP child. Now the assessment for visual, hearing, development and intelligent question should be done. For visual assessment in less than 3 years age group, miniature toy test. For 3 to 5 years age group, illiterate e-test. For more than 6 years age group, senilence chart. And cover test should be performed to detect the strabismus. Hearing assessment should be done in less than 6 months. Behavior, observational audiometry, between 6 to 24 months of age, visual reinforcement audiometry, and between 2 to 5 years age, play audiometry, and in more than 5 years age group, audiometry should be performed. For DQ and IQ assessment, Denver Developmental Screening Test, Trivandrum Developmental Screening Test, and Vestibular Intelligence Scale, Bayley Scale, all should be performed to assess the DQ and IQ. Now the treatment part. It is most important part of this lecture. In this, I will tell you what are the drugs indicated for cerebral palsy, then rehabilitation therapy, then surgery, and then supportive treatment in cerebral palsy. Drugs to treat the spasticity are baclofen, diazepam, dantrolene, tizanidine, and botulinum toxin type A. You can easily remember it by the trick B2, D2 and T. B2 is baclofen botulinum toxin, D2 diazepam and dantrolene, and T is the tizanidine. Baclofen is a agonist of GABA B receptor. It acts on posterior horn of spinal cord neurons. It inhibits the excess excitatory activity. Dose is 0.22 mg per kilogram per day, QID orally, or intrathecally can also be given by the intrathecal pump. Side effects are it lowered the seizure threshold. Whenever you stop the drug, there will be seizure occurs. Hypotonia and ataxia can also be the side effect. Diazepam acts on GABA A receptor. Its dose is 0.01 to 0.3 mg per kilogram per day, BD orally. Drowsiness, cognitive dysfunction are the common side effect. In children, we generally use these two drugs, baclofen and diazepam. Dantrolene, tizanidine is very rarely used. Dantrolene act on calcium channel and it decreases the power of muscle contraction. Dose is 0.5 to 10 mg per kilogram per day, BD orally. Diarrhea, vomiting are the side effect, and main side effect, hepatotoxicity. For this, we have to monitor the patient. Tizanidine is the alpha-2 adrenergic agonist. It modifies the excitatory transmitter activity. 1 to 2 mg per day, BD orally. Side effects are hypotension and dry mouth. Botulinum toxin blocks the acetylcholine release from presynaptic terminal. It blocks that signal transmission at NM junction. It is given injection 3 to 9 units per kg into the specific muscle group. And its effect hardly persists beyond the 5 months. So every 3 to 5 months we have to repeat if we want. Side effects are muscle weakness, fatigue, flu-like symptoms, dry mouth and incontinence. So all these are the drugs for spasticity in spastic CP child. Drugs to treat dystonia are in a athetoid CP when the patient is having the dystonia. लिवोडोपा, ट्राईहेक्सीफेनिडिल एंड क्लोनेजेपाम. लिवोडोपा इज कन्वर्टेड टू डोपामिन देन एक्टिवेट द डोपामिन रिसेप्टर्स एंड इट्स डोज इज 0.5 टू 2 मिलीग्राम पर किलोग्राम पर डे बी डी ओरली. साइड इफेक्ट्स आर नोजिया, वॉमिटिंग, डायरिया, एनोरेक्सिया, कॉन्स्टिपेशन, कन्फ्यूजन एंड हाइपोटेंशन के नकार. ट्राईहेक्सीफेनिडिल इज मस्कुरेनिक एसिटाइल कोलिन रिसेप्टर एंटागोनिस्ट. इट्स डोज इज 0.25 मिलीग्राम पर किलोग्राम पर डे बी डी ओरली. इट कॉजेज द ब्लड वीजन, ड्राई माउथ, कॉन्स्टिपेशन, यूरिन रिटेंशन, मेमोरी लूज, कन्फ्यूजन, रेस्टलेसनेस, इंसोमनिया एंड नाइटमेयर्स. क्लोनेजेपाम एक्ट ऑन गाबा ए रिसेप्टर. डोज इज 0.5 टू 4 मिलीग्राम पर डे बी डी ओरली. इट कॉजेज सेडेशन, कन्फ्यूजन, इम्पेयर कोऑर्डिनेशन एंड डिप्रेशन. दीज ड्रग कैन बी यूज टू ट्रीट द डिस्टोनिया. Drugs to treat the chorioathetoid movements. We can use the rizarpine, tetrabenazine, and haloperidol. Rizarpine inhibits the catecholamine pump on adrenergic neuron, inhibiting the uptake of norepinephrine, dopamine, serotonin into the presynaptic storage vesicles. Dose is 0.01 to 0.02 mg per kilogram per day BD orally. Maximum we can give 0.25 mg daily. Common side effects are nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, chest pain, bradycardia, difficulty in breathing, decreased appetite and dry mouth can occur. Tetrabenazine site of action is it depletion of monoamines such as dopa, serotonin, norepinephrine, histamine from nerve terminals occur. Dose is 12.5 to 25 mg daily divided in BD orally. Drowsiness, depression, restlessness can occur. Haloperidol, it blocks the dopamine D2 receptors in the brain. Dose is 0.5 to 3 mg per day BD orally. Dizziness, headache, lightheadedness and drowsiness can occur. So all these are the drugs to treat the chorioathetoid movements in a athetoid CP child. In rehabilitation therapy, we have to give the physiotherapy to each and every cerebral palsy patient to prevent and retard the development of muscle contracture and to improve the various motor function. And at least 3 times in a day, at least for 10 minutes, physiotherapy should be done. In occupational therapy, it is useful for promoting the use of upper extremities for activity of daily life. So patient will be able to do the routine daily activities. Example, bathing, eating, everything. So physiotherapy is mainly for the lower limb functions and occupational therapy is mainly for the upper limb functions. Speech therapy. Speech therapist should promote the acquisition of functional means of communication by giving the speech therapy, because speech impairment is an associated part of cerebral palsy. Educational therapy should be given. Mild CP child can be educated in mainstream school, while the moderate and severe CP child requires the special school to get the education. Then proper family counseling should be done, because the care of CP child is only possible when the family is well trained and well educated about the condition of the CP. After the medical therapy and rehabilitation therapy, surgery is the third part of treatment. It is required in a very severe patient who are having the spasticity and contracture after few years. In this selective dorsal rhizotomy, in which lumbar laminectomy between L2 to L5 is done, neurectomy in which the removal of nerve is done, and neurolysis in which the phenol or alcohol blocks to disrupt the transmission of nerve signal to the brain is done. So chemical neurolysis is generally preferred for this. These surgeries are required after few years in a child. There are a few orthopedic surgeries are required in which tendon transfer or release, adductor tenotomy, psoas transfer and release to for the spasm or spasticity. Tendon lengthening, osteotomy and orthodesis, serial plastering of limbs and intermittent stretching, spinal brass, molded jackets, spinal fixation for the scoliosis is done. In supportive therapy, assistance of adaptive equipment such as walker, pose, standing frame to increase the functional skill and to prevent the contracture. For feeding difficulties, upright position during and after feeds, thickening of feeds should be done. And for constipation, increased fluid intake, high fiber diets and lactulose should be given. For visual and hearing problems, ophthalmologist and ENT checkup should be done regularly. For prevention, in antenatal period, chorioamnionitis prevention should be done. Prevention of preterm and low birth weight birth. Prevention of birth asphyxia, intraventricular hemorrhage should be done. Iodine and iron supplementation should be given to the mother. Steroid to the mother in preterm labor. Magnesium sulfate, this is a trial. When magnesium sulfate is given to the mother, there is a low chances of developing the CP child. Drugs to prevent the seizure will be discussed in next lecture. And thank you. If you have any query, you can put into the comment box.